Hey everybody, it's Camera Tim. I'm here to show you a bunch of keyboard shortcuts you might not have known about in DaVinci Resolve and stuff. Now, keyboard shortcuts are crucial to almost any workflow, but it can be really daunting to figure out exactly what keyboard shortcuts do, how they function, how to best use them, and which ones are the best use case for your scenario. And because there are hundreds of different shortcuts, I figured I'd make this video hours long. Just kidding. I chose a select bunch that I use in my personal workflow, so hopefully these can give you some ideas and inspiration. Woo! You're not a shortcut, get out of here.
Click me.
No, that'll just pause the video. Wait, did you just... So jumping right into Resolve, to find the keyboard shortcuts panel, just go up to DaVinci Resolve and keyboard customization, and it's going to show how I have it personally set, but I recommend you setting it customized to your liking. Now the first one is the most simplistic, but it's also one I use the most, and it's called Split Clip. And all this does is wherever the playhead is, it'll make a cut on the clip that you have the playhead over top of. And these track selectors on the left actually matter for the split clip as well, but we'll get that in a bit. I personally bind Split Clip to C, but by default it is Control Backslash. And the next one that's also pretty simplistic that I use a ton is the Select Nearest Clip shortcut. And then there's the other variation of it, which is the Select All Clips Under Playhead shortcut. The former, the Select Nearest Clip, basically just selects the clip that is closest to the playhead, prioritizing the video layer first. But if I wanted to select every single clip under the playhead, I would use Shift D for Select All Clips Under Playhead. And some of these shortcuts don't have any defaults, so you will have to go to the keyboard customization to bind them. The next two select variants we have are Select Clips Forward on this track and Select Clips Forward on all tracks. And there's also the backward variants of both of these as well that you can bind. And they will work the exact same way, it's just in reverse rather than forward. So I'll show you the forward one first. So if you use the Select Forward on this track, that means it'll select all the clips on that track ahead of the playhead, including the one that the playhead is on. And the Select All Clips version will select every single clip on all layers after the playhead, like so. And then we have the backwards one. If we use backwards on this track, goes backwards from the playhead on every single clip behind it, and then the All will do every single clip on every layer from behind the playhead, including the one that it's on. And with all the selecting we've got going on, let's say we wanted an easy way to deselect everything without having to move the mouse and click in some other window accidentally. We can just use the deselect all shortcut. So I can just use that shortcut here and boom, everything is deselected. Now the next one we have here is enable clip. And what this one will do is physically turn a clip on and off without having to delete the clip so you can look and see what's underneath it. So if we go into our timeline and let's just say I wanted to deselect this, but I can keep the audio in there, I can just press the enable clip button and that'll completely disable that clip. And I can press that same shortcut again to re-enable it. And anything that's highlighted will get enabled slash disabled. And this is how that works. Now let's go back to those track selectors real quick. Now here we have what's known as the auto track selector, and I have all of my audio layers set to Alt and then numbers 1 through 8 respectively, and then Alt 0 meaning all audio. And then I have the same thing for all the video layers, except using Control instead of Alt. And if you do have more than 8 video or audio layers, then the All Video or All Audio shortcuts will in fact do 9 and above. But if we look right here, currently we have all of our video and audio layers enabled. If I just turn off video layers 1 and 2, like so, and then I can use that previous shortcut we've used to select a clip, you'll notice that it selects a clip at the top, but if I turn that one off and select the first layer, and then I press select again, now it selects whatever's on the first layer. And this is useful for selecting everything under the playhead too. So if we use our All Clips Under Playhead shortcut with this track selector, it'll select all the clips under the playhead that are enabled on the track selectors. This also applies to the forward and backward shortcuts as well. The only exception to this being this little toggle right here. This is known as a track destination selection. And just a real quick extra tidbit shortcut here to move those track destinations up and down. By default, you have Control Shift down and Control Shift up. And then audio, these are the defaults as well. Control Alt down, Control Alt up. And essentially what those do is those will move that track destination up and down. So if you want to switch which individual track you're selecting forward on, you just change that destination. And then if we use that track forward shortcut, we get those tracks. And I can bring my audio down here. And if we use the select forward shortcut now, we get those tracks. The next ones we're going to look at are our select edit point types. And the ones we're going to focus on are edit point type, select nearest audio edit point, select nearest edit point, and select nearest video edit point. And to show how these edit points work, if I press the select nearest edit, it'll select the nearest edit point regardless of whether it's a video or audio clip. And let's say I just split this over here and I use the nearest edit shortcut from here. It goes to the nearest point regardless of whether it's video or audio, of course. And then if I select the nearest video edit point, it'll go to the nearest video. And if I press select audio, it'll select the nearest audio edit point. And then if we use our edit point type shortcut, you'll notice that it's changing the edit point from either the beginning of the next clip, the end of the previous clip, or both clips at the same time. Now this edit point type is useful because we can use it with our next shortcut, the extend edit shortcut. So when we have an edit point type selected, if we use extend edit and it's on both clips, it'll move them both equally to the playhead. If we have the beginning of the next clip selected, it'll move just that part of the clip to the playhead. And same is true with the end of the previous clip. If we go behind it, press extend edit, it'll move it back accordingly. And if we use extend edit to overwrite a clip, it'll just go right over top of the next clip. And the same is true in the other instance as well. Now, if you have an edit point selected and you go to the next or previous edit point, if there are multiple edit points on that frame, it'll highlight both of them, provided that that layer is actually selected. Now, on the subject of trimming, one of my favorite shortcuts to use is the ripple start to playhead and ripple end to playhead. And what's really nice about these shortcuts is I can bring clips that are either ahead of the playhead or behind the playhead to the playhead without having to make any sort of additional cuts. This is incredibly useful for an interview or even when I'm just making my YouTube videos and I need to cut out a gap between when I stop talking and when I start talking again. So in this example, I can go to this point where he stops talking. I can just make the cut here initially, and then I can go to the point where I want to have him start talking again, which would be right around here. And the end the playhead shortcut is super useful because I can bring everything that's ahead of the playhead to the previous edit point and keep the playhead basically exactly where it is, but I've cut everything in between the last edit point and where the playhead is. And it'll ripple all of the layers as well. And the start to playhead is somewhat similar, but essentially instead of the playhead shifting back to the previous edit point along with everything ahead of it, wherever the next edit point is after the playhead, it'll bring that all back to where the playhead is and basically do a ripple trim from that point. And I can show that on multiple clips too. So if I see this cut here, if I do my ripple start to playhead, it'll bring everything back to where the playhead is from their respective edit points. And if I do the inverse and I go ahead of the edit point, and then I want to ripple everything from this playhead back to this edit point right here, I do the end to playhead shortcut. And that brings everything to this point right here. I definitely suggest checking out the resize and roll shortcuts as well and experiment on those for yourself. Now, up to this point, we haven't mentioned a key aspect of how clips are linked together. And that is where this link selection tool comes in. And I personally have it bound to Control Shift L. But just to describe what this does in short, if this is turned on, then if there is a chain link on a clip, and I select it, it'll select anything that it is bound to. But if we wanted to keep that link selection on, but still move a couple clips independently, there's a couple ways we can do that. First, we can highlight these clips, and then we can just do the link clips shortcut, and that'll either disconnect or connect whatever you have highlighted. So now, even though this link selection is on, I can select them independently of each other. And if I wanted to rebind them together, I can just highlight them both, and then select the link clip shortcut. Now, the reason the link selection matters is because it actually does affect how things are selected with the previous shortcuts we learned. And just as a quick example of this, so we have our link selection turned on currently. If I disable my audio one and make a selection, it's still going to select both the video and audio clips because this link selection tool is on. However, if we disable it and then make the selection again, it's only going to select the video layer. Or if we do the inverse here, it'll only select, well, it's got the third one on, it'll only select the audio layer. And if we turn link selection back on with only audio selected, it'll still select both video and audio. Now, believe it or not, those are the last selection shortcuts that we're going to learn.
Yay!
These next few shortcuts can be a little bit more fun. And so the next one we're going to look at is the nudge shortcuts. Now, I'm omitting subframe left and right because that usually just applies to audio. But I haven't personally found much of a use case for it anyways. So we're going to look at our one frame left and one frame right and multi-frame left and multi-frame right, which is 5 frames. So with these clips selected, if I use the nudge one frame left and one frame right, you can see it's just moving the whole clip left and right like so. Or if we use our multi-frame, we can see it goes 5 frames left and 5 frames right. And that happens on whatever is selected. And now we have transitions. Do you like that one? Don't tell me it was a star wipe. If that was a star, I'm firing myself. And so the transition shortcuts we're going to look at here are add audio only, add transition, and add video only. So if we go to a clip that we want to add the transition to, we can use the select nearest edit point that we had earlier, and then we can either press Shift T, which will add an audio transition, we could press Control T, which will add a video transition, or we can press Alt T, which will add a transition on both the video and audio layers. And the edit point type will tell us where we're going to put the transition. So if I have it set to the beginning of the next clip, it'll place the transition at the beginning. If I place it on the end of the previous clip and I press it, then it adds it to the end of that clip and transitions to the next one. We also have these multicam cut and switch shortcuts that I've shown in previous videos, but I'll show them here again. And I'm also going to add a little quick tidbit right here. I've already placed these into a timeline, but let's just hypothetically say I didn't. What I can actually do is make sure I go to the folder that they're in. I can press Control A, which is a standard select all shortcut. And then I can press my insert shortcut. And that'll place them all into my timeline here. And the reason I bring this up is because actually on the cut page, we have a slight additional feature on the cut page. So you'll notice we have this little arrow here that kind of points to where the edit is. If I go to the previous edit point here, what I can do with this is if I go to add another random clip in here, I can add this into the source viewer. If I press F here for insert, that basically does what's called a smart insert, and it'll insert the clip wherever this arrow is pointing. And if you didn't want to use where that smart insert is, an easy workaround for that is just by making a cut and then inserting. Or you could just do it on the edit page. And then a couple more quick things before we actually get to our multicam cut and switch is we actually need to set up our multicam sequence. So in order to do that, we can use our select forward shortcut here, and I'm going to use the alt up shortcut, and that'll move everything that's selected up a layer. There's also alt down, which moves everything down a layer. And the interesting thing with this is if you have video and audio selected and you press alt up, it'll actually move audio down. If you have audio only selected and you press alt up and alt down, it'll actually move them up and down. So it actually changes the behavior based on whether or not there is a video track highlighted. But we're just going to go ahead and make sure all of them are on different layers like so by using select forward and alt up for every point. And then we can just press Control A for select all. And then we're going to use the auto sync by waveform shortcut. Just make sure inside the keyboard shortcuts you select the one that's under the clip tab and not the one that's under the media pool tab. And then just a quick note on auto syncing, just ensure that whatever audio you don't want to move is on the uppermost layer. And then just to clean this up a bit, we can just use our delete empty tracks shortcut here. And that'll get rid of any extra layers that has nothing in it. And if we have an instance where we, let's just hypothetically speaking, say we had multiple clips like so, we could use the delete gap shortcut, which snaps everything together quite nicely. And then we can go up into our media pool here, and I'm going to make this a multicam clip. So we can just convert the timeline to a multicam clip here. It'll disappear from the timeline view. By the way, I have this under the timeline view options open, the stack timelines button. So that's how I'm able to see this and add a new timeline here. And I can just drag this into my timeline here. And now I need to make sure that my resolution is correct. You get your resolution correct, kids. But now I'm just going to turn off the inspector so I can see my source window here. And now I can see all three of my cameras simultaneously. And at any time I want to switch my camera using shortcuts, we have our multicam cut and switch. I have mine set to 1 through 9 accordingly for cut. And then for switching, I have the numpad numbers 1 through 9. And once we're on multicam view, we can scroll through and just make a cut and switch cameras just by pressing the number buttons. If we decide later that we wanted to go to a different camera at a different point, we can just select whatever clip that was and use the numpad numbers, and we can switch it without making cuts. Now, this is also an instance where I would typically unbind the audio just because you don't want that one to keep switching over and over again. So there's two ways you can do that. You can either highlight all of it and then unlink them, or you can right click on your audio and then flatten it accordingly. Either way will unbind them from being affected by the cuts. Other shortcuts that we can use are the classic J, K, and L shortcuts. And these are just simple playback shortcuts that allow us to play at different speeds or play in reverse or stop. So if I press L, it'll start playing the clip. If I press it again, it'll play at 2x speed. Press it again at 4x, press it again 8x speed. You get the gist. Same is true with J. If I press J once, it'll start playing back normal speed in reverse. If I hit it again, it'll go 2x speed, play again 4x speed, hit it again 8x speed, and it'll keep going, etc., etc. And then you can just press K to stop. And last but not least, we have our freeze frame shortcut. And this one is great because let's just say I wanted to select this clip and freeze it. All I have to do is just press Shift F, and wherever the playhead is where I use that shortcut is the frame that it'll freeze the whole clip on. And if we wanted to unfreeze it for any reason, we could just go into our change clip speed. I have that bound to Shift R, so I can just press Shift R on this clip, and we can just check the freeze frame button here. And this is what we activate when we use the freeze frame shortcut. So hopefully this gave you a great start into introducing keyboard shortcuts to your workflow. If you want to see more keyboard shortcuts like these, or you want to dive into the Fusion, Color, or Fairlight pages and see what more shortcuts there are, please let me know in the comments, or let me know what your favorite keyboard shortcut is, especially if it's one I didn't mention. If you're wondering why my shirt is different, you're weird. And if you'd like to see me press a bunch of buttons and break stuff live, follow me here, because I'll stream there. That's where I am. It's my happy place. And if you want to see some more weird stuff, check out this video where I talk about freeze frames and how to make them and how to do image stills and all that stuff. And then there's this video over here. Oh man, this is crowded. This is about multicam. Watch it. Cool. I'm signing out. Bye-bye. Those are shortcuts to other videos.